Wow. I can't believe I'm going to be doing this, but I'm going to do it anyway. Okay, so I just got word from my friend Whitney McLaughlin, aka W. McLaughlin 56 on DeviantArt. She has a YouTube channel, but and keep in mind, I'm trying to tell you this with a straight face because this is really, really shocking to me. I never expected this to happen. I didn't even know that this happened until several days after the fact. But Whitney McLaughlin basically sent me a note earlier today, 2:10 p.m. Eastern Standard, my time zone. You can figure out where that is on your own. But basically, what it boils down to is that her friend and the same friend of which who did character artwork for many of her characters, you know, just, you know, basic requests, right? He did his own take on many of her characters. Unfortunately, and I cannot believe I'm having to tell you people this, and I've never done something like this before, but Ken Lopez, aka Luna the Fox Forever, that's all one word, all lowercase, has apparently died in a terrible vehicle accident. Terrible vehicle accident. A car crash, basically, took his life. Now, before I introduce you guys to his artwork post-mortem and pay a tribute to him, because this is what this episode of Savage Level meant. I meant to say reaching out to the unfamous, but you already get the picture, so it's good. Going to be about mainly is about paying tribute to the artist who for close to 12 years was a member of the DA community of DeviantArt before his unexpected car accident that led to his death. This guy, judging on what I've seen earlier today in his artwork, has a very, very Pendleton Ward inspired art style. His art style is very refined, very mature, very unique in of itself. And all artists are unique, but in his case, his art is especially more so than others. This guy, God, I can't believe he died though, you know? And from what I've heard, he apparently died several days ago, hence why I mentioned that he died several days after the fact. Why I'm mentioning this to you now, several days after the fact, as of this recording, July the 6th, 2018. The time, of course, 2:30, a little bit over. But this guy is an amazing artist. He has a unique capability, and he was born in a pretty understandable household, a pretty respectable neighborhood, March the 28th, 1991, and having been a deviant artist for close to 12 years, his career as an artist and his life had to come to a tragic end on, of all days, July the 4th. So several days ago, I would think. Or is it July the 3rd? I forget. But it was several days ago as of this recording when he died. And I really I'm expressing to you this, I'm stressing this to you because he died age 27, which is kind of a curse to many people because that's the age in which many artists, past and present, have died. You know, George Gershwin, he died age 27. Kurt Cobain, he died age 27. I think Amy Winehouse died age 27. Or maybe not, it just depends on what you see on her wiki. And now we can add another person to this list, unfortunately, in the form of Ken Lopez. And I can only imagine how much further he would have matured as an artist had that car not taken his life. So, at the behest of my longtime DeviantArt friend, Whitney McLaughlin, and all of you who knew Ken Lopez's work under the Luna the Fox Forever DeviantArt Gallery, I'm going to pay tribute to him by basically just showing to you a few of his best artworks from each of the years that he was active as a deviant artist up until his passing. And I'll just go ahead and I'm gonna start chronologically from earliest to latest. So this covers his entire artistic career. And that is the reason for me doing this Savage, for this Reaching Out to the Unfamous tribute show in honor of the man known as Luna the Fox Forever. And I say the word forever very, very emphatically, despite with not much emotion, because this guy's art is going to live forever in our hearts and minds. This guy was a great artist, and he'll always be known as a great artist, and possibly that much more. So, let's get started. I can't believe this. You know, I can't think of many people. I can't think of many people in this world, or probably any other, that would probably be this genuinely talented, this original, as a whole, as this guy. You know, Ken Lopez, and I never met the guy, I never got a chance to know him personally, but I do know that before I died, I managed to fave one of his works. And Ken Lopez, known by the DeviantArt username Luna the Fox Forever, this guy is legit at what he does. He is legit. I don't think there are going to be many other people like him after we're gone. But I do see a lot of people doing what they can to follow in his footsteps. By the way, this first deviation of his that he submitted way back in around May or June of 2008, that deviation of his is so legitimately, it's just so legitimately awesome that you cannot help but simply enjoy the simplicity and the whimsicality of it. And moving on to this picture now. You see, this picture reminds me of like a side-scrolling video game, like Undertale. Except this guy was clearly inspired by side-scrolling games, and so he thought it'd be a good idea to come up with a few compositions of his own inspired by his love for side-scrolling games. So he came up with this second deviation that I'm obviously featuring here. Now this guy, let me tell you, Luna the Fox Forever, this guy is just really, really talented at what he does. I don't really know for sure that there will be another like him, but you know, as I look through his gallery, every day he does something new. Just about. You might not see it specifically in his deviations, and you might not even see it at all in some cases, but at the end of the day, he lives through his art because he is his art. And you know, there are actually like five more deviations that he submitted prior to the last one that is in this slideshow, which I've obviously composed for you guys. And the reason why I've operated this slideshow at such a very, very lengthy pace, at such a slow pace, is because I wanted to show to you, just as he himself would, the importance, the sheer magnitude of his inspiration for life. Anything that he sees, just like with all artists, is an inspiration to him. It inspires him, it motivates him, it fuels him. You understand? And this guy, he really does create some next level kind of art. And I'm not just saying this because when I looked at this picture of one of his dogs, was it Rico or Nico? I forget. But he had to give up his dog for adoption because the economy in 2009 was going to shit. And guess who started it? George W. Bush. And Barack Obama, knowing that he was going to take all the flack for it, just like Herbert Hoover did when he took the reins from Calvin Coolidge, knowing all that, Guess what happened? B.O. made it that much worse. Barry Sotero Obama made it that much worse. And I believe, from what I can see, that was what he was going for. And I can see it wholeheartedly, without any question or doubt in my mind. And I see it because it's a fact. This guy lives through his artwork because he is his artwork. And by the way, there's really no telling how much he was able to do in his short life and his 10 years as a deviant artist prior to having done whatever it was that he did. But, you know, he got injured in that car accident a couple nights ago, and that killed anything that he was going to produce. That ended his life very short. And, you know, there are quite a few people in history who have died at his very age, at 27. You know, Kurt Cobain. I'll type up a few right now. I'll do a Google search. I will do a Google search right now. There are literally so many people who died aged 27. I mean, there's this guy named Jimi Hendrix. He died at 27. Janis Joplin, she died at 27. Jim Morrison, he died at 27. George Gershwin, he died at 27. You know, it's just... it's a 27 club, basically. And Ken Lopez, being the remarkable artist that he is, and I say is because he's going to live through his art forever, even though he's dead, he has the unfortunate distinction of being a member of that 27 club of famous people who died age 27. There is actually a Wikipedia article regarding this club of people who have died age 27. And it's just so, it's crazy to me. It's crazy, man. It's really, it's just, I mean, you look at all the people who died age 27. You know, the conductor, composer, and pianist Alexander Levy, 1892, died 27 years of age. His death is unknown. Louis Chauvin died in 1908. Neurosyphilitic cirrhosis, or sclerosis, or chlorosis, or whatever. Robert Johnson, the infamous blues singer known as Mashed Potato Johnson, he died age 27. Apparently, he was poisoned, or he poisoned himself, one. Nat Jaffe, he died in 1945, aged 27, from high blood pressure complications, and the list from the first recorded known death of a person aged 27 from 1892 onward just goes on, and there are several gaps in between entries by at least maybe I would say 10 or more years, but between 1964 and now, you will find that such instances occur at an alarmingly quicker rate. And that's not because just of the fact that this human population is increasing at a rate that we somehow managed to control now, for whatever reason, but just in the 70s alone, there were about 1, 2, 3, 4, there were about at least 13 or 14 people who died aged 27. And it's just crazy because this one guy, Pete Ham, for instance, he hung himself because he couldn't deal with the pressures of life. And he was 3 days from turning 28. So had he died 3 days later, that would officially not make him a member of the 27 Club, because he would have been 28 when he died, not 27. But that still makes him a member of this ill-fated club nonetheless. And in another case, Maria Serrano, 2001 she died. 2 days before her 28th birthday, she died in a plane crash. You know? And the fucking notoriety of so many infamous and popular and renowned people, artists, musicians, anyone of any trade whatsoever, they end up dying at age 27. And especially, you know, with this picture that he submitted, the picture that you're seeing now, the picture that he had submitted to his gallery some time back, I think it was in the middle part of his art career. Despite the fact that it looked like something out of a war zone, he wanted to promote a message of hope, of tranquility, of future peace, through wisdom, through understanding. He wanted to express those thoughts in this picture, which looked like something out of a slum. And then we have something like this. We have something of this caliber. And this is, I think this is a remake of his first particular drawing. I don't know for sure if it is or not, but from what I can tell, He was pretty much, he either inspired the Meatly to create Bendy and the Ink Machine, or he was inspired by the Meatly's Bendy and the Ink Machine game series itself. And I forget which is which, but depending on when this was released, he could have inspired it and not the latter. But, I mean, it just depends, so there you go. But this guy, through his art, through his very unique art, he explained through his art that it doesn't just take someone of fame or fortune to make something stand out, you see? It takes something more humble, like something out of sheer obscurity of some kind. You know, things of that sort. And yet at the same time, he wanted to live through his art, which is what so many people strive to do, but so few actually succeed at doing at the level in which he has. Or did, depending on how you want to look at this guy. But this guy, man, he is and was probably the most gifted artist, genuinely, and not necessarily just in terms of style, but as a whole. You could only imagine how many friends this guy must have made before his untimely passing, and it's just crazy, because he was a founder of a DeviantArt group, which basically encourages the shipping of original characters. I mean, this guy only had 209 watchers, but still, that's a hell of a success in my book. 41,000 views over 12 or so years, that's a hell of a success. Many people online don't even get that. So he's extremely fortunate, especially when it comes to a screenshot that he took while playing Minecraft. Now keep in mind, he was actually, I believe he was legitimately playing this game. I don't know if this is true or not, I'm just speculating here. I'm not going to assume, I'm just going to speculate. But this guy, being the avid gamer that he was, when he made that screenshot, a whole new side of him was made real to us. He unleashed that whole new side. And of course, with his other popular work, you know, his latest, one of his other traditional works. Now, again, I'm going to speculate here, but I think he may have edited this in DA Mural to edit the sharpness settings on a general level, not on the advanced level that I do with my photographs and stuff, because what I do is just, it goes beyond seeing, because some of it is just so remarkably abstract, so remarkably avant-garde. But about this guy's art, especially through this picture, what you're seeing right now, it's just so, it's so remarkably carried out, so exquisite. How the hell does anyone make something like that and, I mean, you know, honestly. But moving on to another later picture of his, which is during the twilight and the last and final months of his life, unfortunately, but the twilight of his career. I believe he was trying to portray Lord Dominator from Wander Over Yonder or make an original character for it, one, but the fact that he decides to come up with something more mature, more risque, that shows that he has matured, not just as an artist, but a person, because he understands the ins and outs of stuff and anatomy in general. And you know, this guy, he is just, this picture is so spot on, man. It's so spot on. Like, you cannot make something any better than this. Even on your best day, if you were given an hour to just come up with something like this at an art school, because they want you to draw like Van Gogh. This guy didn't draw like Van Gogh, but damn it, he drew, and he drew like a champ. He put butts in seats, and that's what I'm talking about here. When your art is so good that it puts butts in seats and gets people noticing, you know that you're doing something right. And despite the fact that he wasn't very well known, as he only had 209 watchers prior to passing away, or maybe it could have been a bit more than that, I don't know, but he might not have had the biggest fan base. But just in that picture alone, just in that fan art of Wander Over Yonder, that guy clearly showed that he had matured quite a bit. And this photograph, that this meme that he took about the death at that time of legendary Nintendo game maker and developer Satoru Iwata, this guy not only made it a permanent reminder for us to be like the Satoru Iwatas of the world or the Ken Lopezes of the world, he made it his goal in life to remind people that you don't have to be famous to create something memorable in the best way possible, in the most complimentary way. Sure, you're going to have your critics, but if you silence your critics by coming up with something that best describes you as a whole, if you're just completely honest in everything you do, I mean, Ken Lopez was like the Charles Krauthammer of art in the 21st century. He was the Charles Krauthammer of DeviantArt. And he'll still be that way. And the reason why I say this is because when it came to his art, his vast maturity in his art style showed throughout the 10 years in which he had submitted artwork for his gallery. And this one, of course, is one of my personal favorites, along with another one which I'm going to show here in a minute. But this guy is, the artwork here is just, it's beyond words. You can't describe it enough, because words don't do enough. They fail. Words are worthless in describing something like this. And then one of the final submissions in his gallery prior to his passing, which I'll get to in about 3 seconds. This one in particular, this was one of his last submissions. So he figures, well, I don't know what's going to happen to me out there in that car tonight when I go out to go somewhere, but if I do die and a car does hit me at too fast a speed, I'll at least know that I've made at least 210 people in my life happy with the artwork that I've allowed myself to share with them. And I think that's the best possible way you would want to go out. He went out with class, with dignity, with selflessness, with honor. You can't get a better storybook ending than that. You can't. It's impossible. Because, I mean, you know. But anyway, as I've mentioned at the beginning of this video, this is an episode of Reaching Out to the Unfamous, entirely dedicated to this great, wonderful artist and human being in general, who has obviously left us way too soon, who God supposedly took way too soon. But despite that, his artistic legacy, not just as a person, but through his art, is going to live forever. It's going to live forever through his art. And honest to God, I only saw his gallery once, as I mentioned before, prior to his passing. But I saw something in him, and that showed. I don't know if it's the right words to say upon closing this, but aside from that, I'm just going to close it here. So, from all of us at Skull Media Enterprises, Ken Lopez, may you be blessed in the afterlife. Thank you. Thank you for what you've done for us, sir. You will never be forgotten.